Here are 10 practical factors that we should take into account when determining sample sizes. And more importantly, we could also use these 10 factors as arguments to justify our sample size. I want to start by saying that there probably isn't just one single factor that would determine sample sizes. More likely than not, it is a combination of different considerations. As a researcher who writes and submits papers and tries to get them published, but also as a reviewer who reviews papers for various journals, I've compiled the following list of considerations regarding sample sizes. Number one, how big is the population?This is an obvious one. If our research population is big, our sample should be relatively big as well. The implication of this factor on justifying one sample size is the following. If we know we could only get a relatively small sample for our research, maybe we should not define the research universally. So instead of formulating a research question like, how do students in higher education perceive something, we could better ask, how do students in this specific university or faculty perceive something? This way, we conduct the study more as a case study with a more focused population, which justifies a relatively small sample size. Because, after all, the size of the population is a relevant factor for determining and justifying the size of the sample. Number two, what's the population like?Is it homogeneous or is it diverse? Size of the population is not the only important thing. We also need to consider what kind of research population we're dealing with here. A research population which is homogeneous could justify a relatively small sample size, whereas if the research population is really diverse and contains very many different subgroups and subcategories, well, that would probably call for a relatively bigger sample in order for this diversity to be properly represented in the sample.The practical implication of this consideration for researchers is that if we can effectively argue or show some kind of empirical evidence which indicates that our research population is relatively homogeneous, then it is justifiable to some extent that our sample size is also a little bit small. Consideration number three, probability sampling or non-probability sampling.Firstly, let me link up some other videos of mine in which I discussed probability versus non-probability sampling methods. But here for this video, the point I'm trying to make is this. Generally speaking, if we use a probability sampling method to sample, it is more justifiable that the sample size is a little bit smaller. This is because probability sampling methods, by and large, guarantee equal probability. In other words,Under this method, every subject in the population stands the same chance of being chosen as part of the sample, which in turn facilitates representativeness. Although I should note here that in business studies and social sciences, a true probability-based sample is almost never possible. This is because when the research population are actual people, the researcher can never fully control what people do.Put differently, the researcher could try to perform a probability-based sampling procedure, but that does not necessarily result in a true equal probability sample. Because more likely than not, there will be people who simply refuse to participate, even if they're chosen to be part of the sample. Or the participant might intentionally do something weird during data collection that their data is not usable anyway, so they are excluded from the sample ultimately.But nevertheless, the point is this. If we could argue or show that our sampling method is probability-based or at least resembles one, it is then more potentially justifiable that a smaller sample is used. Consideration number four, how many variables are being measured? For certain quantitative studies, there is a general consideration known as sample size to observed variable ratio, which basically looks at the number of participants versus the number of variables being measured. Naturally, the consideration is that the more variables are being measured and are being constructed into the model for testing, the more participants we would need.For instance, for a structural equation paper, researchers may aim for a sample size of 150, which is considered by some as the minimum for testing a structural equation model. And then, depending on the size of the model and the number of variables, additional participants may be required, something like 15 participants for each additional observed variable. These general considerations and rules of thumb could be used by us as researchers to roughly determine and justify our sample size.Consideration number five, is the study qualitative or quantitative? So this is another obvious one. Generally speaking, most of the time, qualitative studies call for a much smaller sample size compared to quantitative studies. People have actually measured this. People counted on the basis of published research and found that the median and average sample sizes for doctoral research in the UK, which used a qualitative research method, was 28 and 31 respectively. I didn't find an average sample size for quantitative studies, but researchers do acknowledge that sample sizes for published quantitative studies are likely much larger. So qualitative studies, smaller samples. Quantitative studies, bigger ones. Consideration number 6, what is the objective of the research study? For instance, is my research a descriptive study focusing on a specific organization? Or is my research a causal study testing some generic cause and effect relationships in general terms among the general population? The first example study probably calls for a smaller sample than the second one. So in many cases, sample size depends on how the research questions are phrased. If a reviewer says that our sample size seems a little bit too small, the researcher could always argue that given the specific manner that our research question is formulated, given our specific research objective, this sample size suffices in collecting adequate data to address this specific research objective. Consideration number 7, sensitivity of the research topic or research method. This is another argument that researchers sometimes use to justify a relatively small sample size. For example, if the survey deals with topics that are considered sensitive, people might be reluctant or hesitant to complete the survey. Similarly, the data collection method could also create such reluctance and hesitation. For instance, sometimes researchers need to have employee surveys and supervisor surveys paired up in dias for the purpose of data analysis. This could also lead to some concerns on the part of the respondents. In these situations, even though the survey might be anonymous, people may still decline to participate. So this could be an argument to justify or at least explain why the sample size is a bit small. Consideration number 8, feasibility and other practical factors. Often researchers would argue, we've done everything we possibly could. Given the fact that our survey is so big, given that potential respondents are so busy, given that we do not hold any authority over potential respondents, given all these and many other practical considerations, we've done what was feasibly possible. Some might consider this a weak argument, and this probably is a bit of a weak argument, especially if we're trying to get published in a top-tier journal. But if you are a student writing a thesis, this may be a completely legitimate argument to put forth. Because, as one individual student researcher writing a thesis, of course there are these practical constraints. So, if you highlight them well, you might use this argument in your thesis to justify your sample size. Within reason, of course. Consideration number 9, effect size, statistical power, confidence interval, sampling error, and other statistical factors and considerations. There are various statistical considerations for establishing and calculating sample sizes. In this video, we're not getting into a lot of details on these factors as this is more of a practical commentary, opinion piece type of video. Let me also note here that relying on statistical calculations to determine sample sizes would probably work the best in a lab setting or other controlled environments. When we're collecting primary empirical data from real people in companies, organizations, businesses, and society in general, things could turn out to be a bit more complex. Lastly, number 10, sampling is often a process of balancing or compromising between practical constraints and the desire to reach higher levels of precision and representativeness. And this act of balancing could be particularly tricky for a student writing a thesis who does not have a lot of time and a lot of resources. So it is good to be clear and transparent about what we have done in terms of sampling, and then try to motivate and justify it. As we discussed earlier, often a probability sample is simply not possible in the real world. So explain that. Explain the difficulties and constraints in trying to generate a probability sample. And it is probably also a good idea to keep in mind that we, most likely, should not claim that our sample is absolutely representative, because your reader, assessor, and reviewers will be more inclined to acknowledge and accept the potential limitations associated with our sample when we are transparent and forthcoming about them, instead of holding on to some false pretense that our sample is absolutely probability-based and therefore 100% representative. My sample size might be a little small, and I was unable to perform a probability-based sampling procedure, but there are still positive features about my sample. So let me highlight these positive features while being forthcoming and honest concerning the limitations. All right, what do you think about all this? What are some smart arguments that you would use to justify your sample size? As always, leave your thoughts and comments down below. Thanks for watching this Randy Ways random video. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.